delle virtù, ma anche dei vizi, che fa ancora più interessante la questione. Abbiamo con noi il cardinale Turkson, il monsignor Dufay, il prefetto e segretario del Dicastero per il Servizio del Sviluppo Umano Integrale. Cardinal Turkson tante volte è stato qua, credo che Monsignor Dufay qualche volta è stato qua. Bentornati e cominciamo subito con Sua Eminenza.
Lui fa
Ah,
italiano.
perfetto, che parla in inglese, Sua Eminenza.
Per creare diversità, no? Lui fa italiano, io faccio un po' di inglese. Good morning to you all. Peace to this house is a prayerful wish with which Pope Francis greets and welcomes the world and all of us into the new year 2019. This wish of Pope Francis for the human family at the beginning of the new year, according to his peace message, derives from the commissioning of words of Jesus to his disciples, whom he sent into the world. His words were, "Into whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. And if there's a sound of peace, your peace will descend upon the house. Otherwise, it will return to you." Now, this greeting of peace with which Jesus sent his disciples into the world echo in its turn the greeting of peace with which God sent Jesus also into the world. The echo is the message of peace which the angels announce the birth of Jesus. And there the angels are said, "Glory be to God in high and on earth, peace to men of God's favor." So the good news of Jesus, whether at his birth or the commission of his disciples into the world, is always to bring peace. And it is the wish and the desire of the Holy Father for the year coming up in 2019 that this gift of the Father, associated with the coming of Jesus into the world, becomes the portion of all of us, and indeed of all of humanity. Entrusted to the disciples of Jesus as they ascend into the world, Jesus and his peace become gifts which the Father freely offers to the world. And it offers them to the world to be received as sons of peace, namely people who dispose themselves to the peace of God and who are ready to work and to commit to the realization of this peace in the world. And so, my dear friends, it is so easily understandable that to dispose oneself for peace and to cooperate with it as sons of peace means that we should make peace happen and we should serve peace in all the instances of the household mentioned by the Holy Father in his message of peace, namely the household of the home, communities, nations, and globally. So we do have an idea of peace, the yearning of the human heart, and also do have an idea of some vices which the Holy Father mentions in this message of peace. Vices like corruption, denial of rights, violence, whether they be active wars or cold wars, disregard and abuse of the rights of people, including that of creation. So, this morning, in presenting the Pope's message, I just wish to illustrate this point of peace which connects with politics. Every household has resources to manage to ensure the well-being of all members of the household. And if we follow the Greeks and call the house oikos, then the management of the resources of the house for the well-being of all becomes economics. And the system of society that oversees the management of the resources of the household for the well-being of the citizens in the house becomes politics. A citizen in a house is a politess, according to the Greeks. And when the citizens organize, either collectively or through representation, to ensure that the resources of the household arrive and serve the well-being of every member of the household, then we have politics working. Therefore, what the Holy Father is wishing the world and all of us is that this politics, or the exercise or the management through policy formulation and the rule of law, that the resources of the household reach and serve the well-being of all, is the great desire of the Holy Father for the year coming up. So politics then, especially in the wish of the Holy Father, should not deprive young people of their future by depriving them of an experience of peace even now. Rather, through civic friendship, mediation, and establishment of relationship, the Holy Father wishes that the year we enter will become a year of peace for all of us, as politics serves civic relationship, mediation, friendship, and the building of friendship among all of us. So I wish to thank you for your kind attention and wish to wish all of you a very Merry Christmas. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Eminence, Monsignor Dufay.
I could continue in English, but I try to speak Italian. Bisogno della indulgenza di tutti per il mio italiano che non è perfetto. La buona politica è al servizio della pace. Presentare la politica come un servizio della pace e dare a questa responsabilità per la collettività una dignità e una visione in un contesto mondiale e locale dove la politica sembra più o meno squalificata, a volte disprezzata. Nel messaggio del Santo Padre si parla prima di tutto di una missione che trova la sua ispirazione nel mandato che hanno ricevuto dagli Apostoli, quando Gesù disse loro: in qualunque casa entriate, prima dite pace a questa casa. Pace a questa casa. C'è una pace da offrire a tutti coloro che soffrono la violenza, il dolore, gli abusi del potere. Una pace che dovremo costruire insieme con la parola, il dialogo e la salvaguardia del diritto. Una pace che dovremo vivere come relazione di rispetto verso il prossimo, verso il povero, verso il creato che è la nostra casa comune. Pace a questa casa. Ma com'è possibile, tuttavia, sviluppare e tradurre in atto il servizio della pace e come può la politica essere pacifica? C'è bisogno di un discernimento permanente per trovare ciò che contribuisce alla costruzione del bene comune e rifiutare ciò che ostacola la solidarietà. Ecco la missione politica, come un cammino quotidiano dell'incontro, del dialogo, della conciliazione e della riconciliazione mutua. Pace alla casa di Siria, di Afghanistan, di Yemen, di tutti i paesi che conoscono la violenza. Questo discernimento è necessario per capire ciò che dice il Santo Padre quando parla della buona politica, perché questa politica che vuole e promuove il bene comune e la pace sociale rompe con la sola ricerca di potere, dell'interesse personale o di uno solo gruppo, che esclude gli altri o non vuole costruire la società in maniera comune. Quando la politica diventa un servizio, ascolta le persone, tutte le persone, accoglie i talenti, particolarmente i talenti dei giovani e le aspirazioni di tutti, con un'attenzione particolare per i poveri e i bisognosi. La buona politica non vuole opporsi ai gruppi o alla comunità etnica, sociale o religiosa. Si fa promotrice invece di tante iniziative per far crescere la relazione tra cittadini. Incontrare, ascoltare, proporre e finalmente decidere per l'avvenire della comunità. Ecco una grande e nobile missione. Lo sappiamo, la pace è fragile come un fiore. Non può esserci la pace senza rispetto reciproco, ospitalità reciproca e mantenimento delle promesse che abbiamo dato. La politica è una parola che chiama la fedeltà e la pace non si riduce a una relazione di forza. Non è un mercato elettorale, un mercato di interesse. È piuttosto un impegno per le generazioni presenti e future. Ma sappiamo anche il futuro inizia oggi. Questa affermazione è stata al centro delle discussioni della COP24 a Katowice, nonostante la resistenza a un accordo. Come servizio della pace, la politica è cura della relazione all'interno della società, così come nella cooperazione tra stati e nazioni con la diversità delle culture e delle storie. La pace richiede prima di tutto il rispetto del diritto e dei diritti umani. Il riferimento alla Dichiarazione Universale dei Diritti Umani che abbiamo celebrato per i 70 anni della sua approvazione mette in luce la dignità della persona umana e i diritti fondamentali, l'educazione, la salute, la cultura, ma anche la libertà di espressione e di religione come condizione di pace. Come ha detto Papa Giovanni XXIII nella sua enciclica Pacem in Terris, i diritti umani sono allo stesso tempo doveri umani. E la relazione, la reciprocità, diritti-doveri è condizione per una società pacifica, con il riferimento nella fede cristiana ad un Dio di amore e di perdono. Il messaggio del Santo Padre non vuole negare le derive o i visi che portano alla morte della politica e della pace, la corruzione, che è un male in tutti i paesi. Il potere del denaro, la relativizzazione del diritto, la xenofobia, il razzismo, l'ideologia che presenta i migranti o rifugiati come nemici o tutti i discorsi che sono incompatibili con una politica di pace e amore sociale. La responsabilità della pace comincia nel cuore della persona e nel cuore di ogni famiglia. Passiamo sempre dalla famiglia umana alla famiglia delle nazioni. La pace tuttavia nasce in ogni persona. Siamo membri di un solo corpo, dice San Paolo. Abbiamo un unico padre che dà la sua pace e la sua grazia a tutti. La parola di Dio che Gesù dà ai suoi discepoli fa di loro attori di pace, beati gli artigiani di pace. Questa pace è sempre pace con gli altri, pace sociale, ma anche pace con la natura e pace con la nostra coscienza. In qualunque casa entriate, prima dite pace a questa casa. Grazie.
Grazie, Monsignore. Adesso la parola a voi, nome e testata.
Giuseppe Rusconi, Inside the Vatican, rossopurpura.org. Ora vorrei chiedere a Sua Eminenza, tutti siamo d'accordo che accogliere un rifugiato è un dovere, Io le pongo questa domanda. Accogliere un migrante è un dovere, secondo lei, o una possibilità che dipende dalla disponibilità anche pratica di chi ospita il migrante? Grazie.
Io direi tutte e due. Cioè, è un dovere, perché ogni manifestazione in senso di carità, in certo senso, non si conserva un dovere. Ma allo stesso tempo, quando Santo Padre ci ha invitato un po' con i suoi quattro verbi, ad accogliere, proteggere, eccetera, eccetera, poi ha aggiunto che ci vuole un discernimento facendo questo, perché tutti devono fare questo qui secondo loro possibilità. Questo discernimento non deve mancare mai nei nostri tentativi di ascoltare questi, di obbedire e poi ecco, mettere in pratica tutti questi quattro verbi. Il discernimento della capacità, la possibilità della persona o del paese o nazione che accoglie queste persone.
Christopher Lamb from the Tablet. My question is for Cardinal Turkson. In this document, you talk about, or the Pope talks about, the fear of strangers, and says that political discourse that opposes migrants is not acceptable. In my country, we are going through the Brexit, which was widely considered to have been caused or voted for because of anxiety about free movement of peoples and immigration. I was wondering what your thoughts are when a country makes decisions based on fear about migrants.
When a country makes a decision based on fear. You know, in this regard, Britain is not the only country. 2 years ago, I was invited to address a conference in Holland, Amsterdam. And the theme that they chose for the conference was angst, okay, fear. And so when I did ask, why did you choose to, you know, to discuss fear? The answer was that because you feel it everywhere. You feel it everywhere, but it was always difficult also to put a finger on it to identify that this is the cause of fear, this is the cause of. So it appears just to have been something that was just present in the atmosphere within the people and within society. The issue of migration might have been the cause, might have been a cause for it. But I would, you know, since this is a phenomenon that is not, this instance of migration is not the only one in history. A small video that Pope Francis did tried to trace migration from way back in history, how the different periods in history have always had an experience of migration. And with that video was just to encourage us to recognize that, therefore, what is happening now is not unique. Probably what we require, what we need to do is, if, you know, just as in the past, it's always been managed, to see how we can manage this instance of migration too. And in this case, also probably seek to intervene to reduce the causes of migration. The sector of our office that deals with this subject, makes two points. Now, when you're talking about migrants, that the focus is where they're going to. When you're talking about refugees, the focus is on what they are moving away from, what is driving them out, what is pushing them out. And so both are two experiences of, you know, mobility of the human person. Migrants move, and this has always been their thing. We move from place to place, provided it's our movement is, you know, so managed that it doesn't constitute a threat to anybody. Presently, that is a big sense, that the movement of people is a threat. That is the impression in Poland, that's the impression in Hungary, that's present or apparently in Britain also was the impression that the movement and the arrival of people constitute a threat. But I suppose we can find ways of managing this so that what appears to be a threat may actually be a resource, maybe something that can benefit the growth of a country Since, as we all believe and say, no man is an island, and our relationship and cooperation can serve to help us grow and to enrich our individualities.
Just 2 points about this question. The Pope said that we have two rights: right to emigrate to ask protection, and the right to stay in our countries. So the question is, how can we develop conditions and cooperations with countries to protect people, especially in war context or in context of climate disasters? We have to think again and to develop a new concept of cooperation between countries, and it's completely in the heart of this message about peace, because peace is the possibility to develop cooperation, a new concept of cooperation, even with a country in war. So it's not only the question to, yes, it's the question of to welcome migrants, but it's also the question to consider the context of migration and the evolution of the countries from where the migrants are coming.
Altre domande? Fate le domande adesso, perché dopo faranno qualche battuta, ma solo per televisione e radio. Quindi, last chance. Ah, viene? Sì, sì.
Good morning. My name is Elena from EWTN. This is a question for Cardinal Turkson. I wanted to know, related to this message of peace, recently there have been some protests in Brussels against the UN Migration Pact. What's your reaction to that with people opposing this potentially good thing for migrants?
Yeah. So this is about the Global Compact signed in Marrakesh, right? The protests and the conditions, you know, so the response was twofold. There were protests, but there were also celebrations of celebrations welcoming the signing of the deal in Marrakesh. For us, our first observation is to note that, you know, the Secretary of State, Cardinal Parolin, was at that event. And so that was to, you know, commit the Vatican's own support to the deal. And he was there basically because, as you may have, this has now become a very, common knowledge. Way before the negotiations began in New York, the sector in our dicastery responsible for migration and refugees prepared a small document of 20 points, expatiating on the four verbs that the Pope had, you know, suggested as whatever. And copies of this went to New York. And we already got word that the body dealing with this so welcomed the document that out of the 20 points that were made, close to all of them probably made it, because the stuff that was going to be discussed in America was made 23 points. Okay, and so we have every good reason to believe that the Vatican's position in this regard made a very useful contribution the protest against it. I suppose the Brexit tendencies are not limited to England. I suppose every country in Europe now has a reason to express some kind of anxiety about the migrants, whatever. And unfortunately, I say unfortunately because the link sometimes between migration and religion, Islamics, is an unfortunate connection. But every now and then there are instances in Europe that just enable people to seize upon that and say, that's what we mean by, you know, being against migration. Like the last instance in Strasbourg, okay, where the mini Christmas market was invaded by somebody and killed on. That, unfortunately, is what fueled this whole anti-migration sentiment. And we would wish that that would kind of, you know, that would cease, so that we'd be able also to, you know, say or address our message of, you know, people being friendly, establishing new relations, and rather discovering the resources that these newcomers or migrants bring. Because we have reason to believe, the proof is there. One big country that is developed and excelled on the resources from outside is the United States. It's not the first country because it had the resources from all over the world. And so we have an instance and a proof that resources from different places can really help us grow. It's a question probably of then, you know, managing all of this and not to be afraid of them or push them aside.
Continue. Okay. Okay. Grazie. Tutte e due saranno disponibili per televisione orario brevemente su Eminenza nel Salottino e Monsignor Dufay vicino al mio ufficio. Grazie.
Come with me.
We're going to try to get one more photo.